All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is, will be day two of the hearing concerning the appeal of Walter Skowronski. Today's date is August the 9th, 2013. And when we left off, I believe Mr. Skowronski was still in the midst of the presentation of his case. Are there any matters we need to address before we get started from the county?
No, sir.
Mr. Skowronski?
Yes, sir. There was a witness yesterday that we didn't get to that I had forgotten about. She was really waiting. She's be on her way. She'll be here around 10.
Right.
I'm going to go ahead and testify myself before she gets there.
Okay. All right. So you may proceed when you're ready. The testimony about to give in the matter now pending before the board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help you God.
I do.
Right. For the record, just state your name, please.
Walter Skowronski.
Okay. Go ahead, Mr. Skowronski.
First, I'd like to start off with some of my background. I've been in law enforcement for 13 years. 7.5 of those years were with the NYPD in New York City. I worked through 9/11. Prior to that, I was in the Army for 5 years active duty, 2 years National Guard. And between the Army and the NYPD, I worked offshore on a drone rig for about 2 years. After I left the NYPD, I moved here basically for a better life for my kids. With them growing up in New York City. With the Forsyth Sheriff's Office for 5 years. During that time, I received some commendations, various letters recommending me for Deputy of the Month, one Deputy of the Month, one time for a hostage situation.
take what it's labeled and then identify what the document is, and I'll ask if they have any objections.
Okay. These are letters basically stating thank you for the outstanding work. The majority of them are that you were recommended for Deputy of the Month by your supervisor. Even though you didn't win, I'd like to thank you for your service. One letter states from an investigator.
Yeah, before we get into what the contents say, are those marked, is that WS2?
Yes.
Okay. So WS2, you wish to, and then into evidence at this time, any objection to those?
No.
Okay. They'll be admitted without objection now.
Six of the letters in here are recommendations or acknowledgement that I was recommended for Deputy of the Month. One is the acknowledgement of winning Deputy of the Month during the while I was off duty for a hostage situation that took place in my neighborhood. One of the other letters is a letter from an investigator commending my police work. In locating a vehicle that was being used in numerous thefts in Johns Creek. I was able to locate the car. Went to pull the car over, the gentleman ran. Never did get him, but being able to get a hold of the car, they were able to find him and eventually arrest him. Continue and go over the violations that the county has brought up against me in the past. The first one was being the AWOL for missing training. There was I did not have it written down anywhere, and it completely slipped my mind. And that was pretty much all in that. As Lieutenant Boone stated yesterday, I was agitated about the fact that nobody called me. Because it is pretty common practice when you show up to training and if somebody's not there, where is he? Somebody give him a call. I let my sergeant know that, but I accepted the punishment because I was not there. The incident with the quartermaster supply, Ms. Barber. At the time that we started speaking, I was pleasant, I was polite. Initially, I told her I'm not putting my vest on because I don't have to wear it. She became rude and demanding, which in my turn escalated me. You're not going to talk to me however you want to talk to me. So it kind of escalated on both ends. Prior to that and after that incident, I was warned by other people that I don't go to supply if she's there. Or if she's there, I don't go to supply by myself. Because of problems they have had in the past with her. The incident with my 8-year-old son in the bus, where I was written up for conduct unbecoming. We pretty much heard the gist of that and tailed my 8-year-old son. If you're messing with my children, I get extremely upset. That's my child. My job as a parent is to take care of them and to do what's right for them the best way I know how. When I called the school, I did say the F word twice to Ms. Estes. Never did I direct the word at her, as in most people would say I would cuss her out. I never cussed her out. I did use language in the sentence. After that incident was closed in the investigation, Sergeant Latonis, who's no longer here, came to me, urged me to make a complaint against the school, because the way he put it to me was that after that incident, they started a witch hunt. The day they called him to go investigate that, the principal put out an email asking everybody in the school if they have ever had a problem with it at any time. The other things were unfounded. The only thing that was founded was the language, because it does violate policy, even though I was off duty and trying to protect my son. In the incident with the private property accident, where again, I was written up for conduct unbecoming. You heard the testimony of the supervisor who spoke to the gentleman, who said he was agitated and rude with him on the phone. Initially, I tried to calm him down. He was not having it. He was irate before I even got there. He was threatening to kick whoever's ass it was that hit his car. It was an 18-year-old girl who parked and touched his bumper when she parked. When she came out, he started yelling at her. Somebody he knew came and had to calm him down because what I was saying was not working. He even stated on the telephone to Sergeant Chilton, if he wasn't there, I probably would have kicked somebody's ass. When I asked the gentleman if he would like an accident report for this, he very rudely said, it's not like I got anything better to do. I stated, well, I do, sir, but I'll do your report for you. He did not like that. After I was done, I gave him this card for his accident report. And he then asked me where the precinct was. He said he was going to go make a complaint on him. I gave him directions. And that was it. I received 8 hours suspension for that due to the fact that I was written up prior for conduct on the common with the school incident. And the way policy is written, if it is written counseling, you cannot fight that. You cannot take it to the civil service board and say, hey, this is what happened. I don't think it's right. It's written counseling. So the second incident requires 8 hour suspension, and that's where I received that suspension. For the evidence, the marijuana, every officer I know does it differently. However, they put stuff in their car, where they put it, how they turn stuff in. Some people wait till the end of the shift. Some people, if you have the time, you go right then and do it. Normally, I process an arrest. If I have time, I go back to the precinct, I drop evidence. On this particular day, I had a juvenile arrest for felony domestic. I had to take this individual to the hospital. I took him to RYDC. And then I was scheduled to work the front desk at the precinct at 1 o'clock. Me taking them to the hospital and going to RYDC went past that. On my way back around 2:30, Sergeant Weeks called me and said, you know, stop, get yourself some food, and then hurry up and get in here. That's what I did. The marijuana, I placed, it was a small amount, and I have plastic containers that I keep in my trunk because I do not like the smell of marijuana. It gives me a headache. Makes me nauseous. So I put it in a plastic container and I leave it in my trunk for two reasons. I don't like to put evidence in the front seat of my car because if I do wind up going someplace else, having to do something, there's stuff in the front seat that the public can see. Everybody in the public's not such a good person. Somebody see a bag of marijuana. Some people don't care if it's a cop car. They might want to take that. They see somebody's purse in the front seat. They don't care. Let's take that. So I put evidence in my trunk. I also put it in that container so I don't have to smell it when I'm driving around. Because I don't know how much experience you gentlemen have with marijuana, but even if it's in your trunk, it'll smell your car up. I went to work at the front desk. While I was there, I got four other reports to do on top of the felony arrest that I had to do. At the same time, Sergeant Weeks came and was telling me he needed a statement yesterday about the ambulance. So I had four reports plus a felony report, and he wanted a statement. The last thing on my mind was marijuana. It was in my trunk. When Sergeant Weeks did come to me and asked me, did you turn that in? And I thought I had. I said, well, I'll check my trunk. And when I did and found it in the trunk, I immediately put it in evidence. Sergeant Weeks testified yesterday, he went behind me, called an evidence tech to check to see if everything was there. And it was still properly packaged and nothing was missing, which there was nothing missing. Everything was secured and the chain of custody was not broken. That was on the 21st. The way our schedule works, we work 12-hour days. You either work 2 days straight or 3 days straight, with either 2 days off or 3 days off, depending on if it's a weekend. That was the 21st, which was a Thursday. The 21st, the 22nd, 23rd, and 24th, I was off. It was a weekend. Friday, Saturday, Sunday, I was off. I parked my car in my driveway. I have a patrol car. I drive any other time, except for work, part-time job. There was no need for me to go in my trunk, so I never noticed it. I worked the 25th and the 26th. During that period, I never had any reason to go into my trunk during those days that I can recall of. The 27th, 28th was off. Again, my car's parked. I rarely go into my patrol car when I was off. On the 30th is when Sergeant Weeks asked me if I had turned that in. And when I checked my trunk, it was in there. So, technically, it's 9 days. Work-wise, it's 3 days. I try not to forget to do things. I do. I'm human. It wasn't for thing to try to sabotage the case or try to keep the marijuana for myself. Nothing nefarious like that. I put it in a container where I couldn't smell it, put it in my trunk. I was busy the rest of the day. Again, completely slipped my mind. There was, and as I said, when it was turned into evidence, it was checked. The chain of custody was still not, was still intact because it had never left my trunk. For the avenues, I've worked the avenues probably over the past year, anywhere from 8 to 10 times without any complaints. Not one complaint. Not even checking in with their security, did I get a complaint? There are many times working there that I didn't see their security, driving around, walking around. There's many times during regular patrol where the avenues was part of my area to patrol. I would go in there, I would do reports in there to be visible in the avenue. I'd go 2 hours and not see a security guard. It's not uncommon. The timesheet which seems to be one of the main issues. I do not have the official timesheet with me. I drew a rudimentary, somewhat what it would look like.
I would object in that his rendition of what the timesheet looks like, we don't know that that is actually what it looks like, so I would object to the introduction of the actual evidence itself, or the exhibit itself.
Like I said, I don't have an original. They don't have an original. I just wanted to give the board, they have been asking questions as far as what the timesheet looks like, how it's kind of laid out. And this would be a better visual than not having anything.
All right. Here's what I'll let you testify to how the timesheet looked. If you want to show that to the board as, this is what, how it looked, you can do that, but I'm not going to allow you to introduce it as an exhibit.
On the top of the timesheet is the avenue's information, their address, who to contact for payment, or if you have any questions. Underneath that, there's a line stating, I worked from blank to blank, and fill in the hours, at a pay rate of $35 for the hour, and a blank for a total of blank, which you fill in. For however many hours you work, you fill in how much you're supposed to get. Underneath that, there is kind of instructions saying, please fill out anything that you may have done during your time here and provide times. So what they like to see is times on the left-hand side and next to it, what you did. Underneath that is a place for us to put our name and our phone number. And there's also a line stating that, which basically is directed towards the people at the avenues. If you have any questions or concerns, please contact me at this number. The timesheet that I turned in, I pre-filled out during work day, which I tend to do if I'm working. I'll fill it out because I pretty much have, when I work the avenues, I have a set way I do things. I'll go and check certain stores and make my rounds around. So I filled out where I would be going. There was no times on it because I fill those out while I'm at the avenues, while I'm doing it. I also did not put in the hours on the timesheet because I hadn't been there. And the payment amount was already pre-filled because that's usually 4 hours. I was also turning in a W-9 that they asked for. My two forms were together. And my initial intention was not to turn in the timesheet. I grabbed both of them and turned them both in. That's why it was blank. They did not call me and say, hey, you're missing stuff here. Apparently they called Captain Hoffman, and it went from there. When Sergeant Weeks spoke to me about it, he told me to go find out what it was and try to correct it, which I did. I spoke to Mr. Turnbull and Mr. Durden, who was here yesterday. During that conversation, I explained to them what happened. I got off work late. The time sheet was not correct. I realize that. I will fix it. Mr. Turnbull willingly gave me the time sheet. I did not ask for it. He gave it to me. Walked over, said, here, you know, you can give me a new one. We had more discussion about how their policies, how they want things done. And I assured him that I work the avenues again. We won't have any issues at all. He seemed satisfied with the conversation and my explanation and how I was going to rectify that. Mr. Turnbull, I did ask him why they did not call me first, because it says on the sheet, if there's any questions, call us. And he said he decided just to call the department, which is his right. But to me, if I have a problem with somebody, I want to call them and give them the opportunity to say, you know, hey, what happened here? That's how I do things. Maybe I expect too much of people, but I expect most people to do the same thing. I mean, to me, it's only fair. If they're not happy with the explanation, you do whatever you want to do. Go make a complaint. You know, however you want to handle it after that. But to me, the initial thing is, I always speak to the person I have an issue with, regardless. Mr. Durden yesterday testified initially that he had two or three people working that night, and during my questioning of him, I reminded him of a conversation we had and asked him if he's remembered telling me that they were shorthanded that night and they only had one person working. And he said yes. So, not really sure. Was there three people or one person? It makes it hard for anybody to see somebody if there's only one person working. Conversation with Mr. Turnbull and Mr. Durden. Mr. Durden also yesterday testified that Mr. Durden seemed satisfied with our conversation and the way it went, and that it was from that point on not a problem. I didn't do another timesheet because basically of the mess that I created, I felt bad for causing this problems with the avenues, with the department. It's only for an hour, which is $35. I think the problems that I caused inadvertently outweighed $35, and I didn't want to pursue that. I just wanted to leave Mr. Turnbull happy and leave it at that, and then next time I work, do it the way they wanted it done. There was never any intention to turn in a timesheet to get paid for it, I didn't do it. There was no intent. There was a mistake on my part. I was asked during my interviews with IA if I would accept the money had I been paid. And I answered yes, because I do not lie. I would have accepted it because I would not have realized my mistake. The question I was not asked was, if the mistake was brought to your attention after you were paid, would you return the money? Well, yes, I would. Of course I would. If somebody shows me a mistake and say, hey, this isn't right, I would definitely return it. I was not asked that question. And if it was a mistake, like I said, and I didn't realize it, why would I not accept the check? It would be dishonest to say that somebody wouldn't. It would be I don't think anybody who makes a mistake and gets payment from that mistake would not accept it if they did not know the mistake was made, if it was not brought to their attention. I've never intentionally done anything dishonest. For the witnesses yesterday, my reputation in the department is I don't lie. I don't lie to a fault. Some supervisors have told me, you're blatantly honest. Too honest. They ask me my opinion. They get it. They don't always like it. If you don't like my opinion, don't ask me for it. I have warned many people, don't ask me my opinion if you do not want it, because I will tell you how I feel about it and what I think is the truth. Plain and simple. You ask me a question about me, I have nothing to hide. Have I made mistakes in my life? Absolutely. Are there things that I wish I hadn't done? Absolutely. Are there things that I'm ashamed of? No. Because that's part of my life. If I was ashamed of them, I would hold on to those and probably be angry about it. And I don't have time for that. I'll be 41 years old Sunday. 13 years of my life I've been a police officer. Going back to New York City, it is a different world there, dealing with people in New York City. The language is much more colorful, to say the least, much more accepted. And just all around, tolerated. It was a big adjustment for me to come down here. I do curse. I curse around my children. Whether people agree with that or not, that's their opinion. It's part of my vocabulary. It has been since the military. The military is very bad for cursing. Kind of stays with you. Working offshore, all men, very vulgar language. Law enforcement, there are very few people that I have come across in law enforcement that don't curse. None that I ever came across in New York. Maybe two down here, Sergeant Porter being one of them. Three, Sergeant Thompson, he never curses. And Sergeant Chill. Other than that, everybody else I work with curse like sailors. Clerk Supply. I've heard him curse like crazy. He works with Chrissy Barber. She stated yesterday she's not used to that language. I don't see how that's possible working with Paul. Paul likes to use colorful language. For the 5 years I've been here, I've received 5 complaints plus the one that I was terminated for. The first 3 years I received no complaints. The last 2 years is where my complaints came from. The 7.5 years I worked with the NYPD, I received no civilian complaints at all. None. Considering the size of the city and the work being done there, that in and of itself is impressive. Most people get complaints. I went my first 7, 8, 9 years without getting any civilian complaints. I must be able to talk to the public decently. Do I have bad days? Of course, I'm human. As we stated yesterday, are we supposed to bring that to work? No, we're not supposed to. I don't know if any gentlemen have had law enforcement experience. The way it is now is, here's your gun, here's your badge, go interfere with people's lives, make life-changing decisions for some people, make life-changing decisions for yourself in some cases. But if somebody's being rude to you, you need to tuck your tail between your legs and keep your mouth shut. Do not speak up for yourself, is basically how they work. You can speak to me on the street almost any way you'd like to. I have to stand there, smile, and walk away. Bad days doesn't go over very well. Some officers don't stand for it at all. They get complaints. Some of them do, some of them don't. Referring to is the timesheet, because there's nothing that I wrote in any of my statements that was not true. That's not what they told me. Not once was explained to me that what you wrote here was a lie. What was explained to me was what you put on this avenue was a lie. That sheet was not turned into Forsyth County Sheriff's Office. It was turned into private business. And that private business, when I went and spoke to them, understood my mistake, was clarified, and was satisfied when I left. So I do not understand the false statements. As far as the theft, attempted to commit a theft, this is the definition of a theft. That's the proper section.
For criminal intent, there's right. Nothing about theft.
Right. The code section that is on the form, on my form, is 16-4-1. Which this is 16-4-1. Is that correct?
That is 16-4-1.
According to this, the violation of the law was a criminal attempt to commit a theft, which they state is Title 16, Chapter 4, Section 1, which is what I printed out here. I'd like to add this.
Any objection?
No objection.
What is that point?
Person commits the offense of criminal intent when, with the intent to commit a specific crime, he performs any act which constitutes a substantial step toward the commission of that crime. Definition, there has to be intent. I never had any intent. When I was asked about it, I freely admitted to a mistake that I made and explained that it was a mistake and there was no intention whatsoever to try to defraud the Evans. Again, the Avenues, Mr. Turnbull, who is the property manager, was satisfied with my explanation. The other violation of law is false statements and writings, which is 16-10-20, which I've also printed out. Conceals or covers up by any trick, scheme, or device, material, fact, make a false, fictitious, or fraudulent statement or representation, or makes or uses any false writing or document, knowing the same to contain any false, fictitious, or fraudulent statement to or entry in any matter within the jurisdiction of any department or agency of state government, or the government of any county, city, or other political subdivision of this state, shall, upon conviction, therefore be punished by fine not more than $1,000. Or in prison for not less than 1 to 5 years, or both. Again, in that statute, it states that willfully, knowingly, as I've stated since the beginning, it was a mistake. I did not intend to turn that in. I did with my other sheep. It was a mistake. I did not knowingly or willfully turn that in. Nor did I try to conceal or hide it after the fact. I was told to go to the Avenues to try to straighten it out, which I did. I was freely given the sheet back by Mr. Turnbull. Once again, he was satisfied with my explanation. Ways that I would be rectifying any future work time that I did there. department saying that I'm being dishonest and trying to commit thefts of that nature. The usual practice that I understand from the solicitor's office regarding cases is that any time a deputy is terminated or resigns under actions that are dishonest, untrustworthy, that they will plead out their cases or dismiss them outright for the simple fact that their reputation is ruined and their integrity is ruined to the point where they're not trustworthy on the stand. Yesterday, before coming inside, I was handed a subpoena by Deputy Skipper from Forsyth County. That being said, at this time, the Forsyth County Solicitor's Office does not deem me to be dishonest, or does not deem my reputation to be ruined. As far as my infractions are concerned, like I said, the majority of them, in my opinion, and opinion of a lot of my coworkers, are minor. Except for the last one. There have been numerous employees throughout the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office that have had much greater infractions and received reduced punishment, no punishment, slap on the wrist, transfer. Some were recommended for termination. They were not. They weren't even demoted. They were just moved. This is a disciplinary record of another employee that I received through open records from Sergeant Boyd.
I would object again on relevance not only to another employee, but also to many of those documents there are from 2006, 2011, and prior years that has no bearing on the current administration's decisions for termination or discipline.
The latest infraction happened January or February of this year. It also shows to me the discriminatory way they deal with punishments.
Is that do those documents, first of all, they're all records you obtained through open records?
Yes. Plans,
so they're official records of the Sheriff's Department. Do they concern one individual or several?
This is one individual.
And you just said that it concerns an infraction that occurred in
2013.
This year.
Yes. Under the new administration.
I'm going to go ahead and allow it as an exhibit. It's only to the extent it shows bias against you. I think it would be relevant. Normally, it would not be. But just so the board can consider everything, this purpose of this hearing is to try to get all the information. So in that spirit, I'm going to allow the document. What's the number?
56.
What I'll do is I'll remove anything that's not from the sheet. Task force officers went to lunch with him on a day he showed up late. After he showed up late, he claimed it was due to a sleep apnea machine, and here's long. While at lunch with the two deputies, who were also on DUI, they smelled alcohol coming from them. They reported it to a sergeant, and then investigated it. They did a PBT on him approximately 4 hours after he reported to work. The results on there are in there. He blew, I believe, a .009, which means he still had alcohol on his. Very minute. But when he showed up, it would have been more. He was driving a patrol car at this time, smelling of alcohol. This individual has worked in spec ops previously, has worked SWAT, has had dealings with Captain Hoffman for many years. They are relatively friendly. Anytime I've ever seen them together, they say hello, they joke about stuff. The final determination was that he be transferred. No other disciplinary action was taken. He was not suspended, not demoted. The only thing they did was transfer him. I think driving around in a patrol car with alcohol, smelling alcohol, is a serious offense. To me, that shows a pattern of it shows how some people get less discipline than others, depending on who you are, where you work, and who you know, whether or not you're liked. As I've stated before, I give my opinions. People don't like that.
Where it was discussed about how to serve your subpoenas?
No.
So you don't have any knowledge of what their opinion is on your credibility or the subpoenas that they chose not to serve because of that, or the ones they chose to serve because credibility wasn't an issue for that particular testimony? In 2011, were you aware of the policy that training was mandatory?
Yes.
And then you testified you forgot to go, is that correct?
Yes.
And you received written counseling for that?
Yes.
And you knew that not going was a violation of policy?
Yes.
Regardless of the reason you knew that?
Yes.
Unless you have a prior clearance not to go.
Correct.
But as I stated before, it was also not a required thing, but it's usually a common courtesy of somebody to call that person.
But there's nothing in the policy about any reminders or anything like that?
No. It's just common courtesy, cops looking out for each other.
And in 2011, were you familiar with what the professional image policy said?
At that time, no.
So you weren't aware that using foul language and being verbally abusive and basically having an unprofessional demeanor was a violation of policy?
I knew that the language was a policy violation somewhere. I didn't know what it fell under.
So you knew the conduct was prohibited by policy. You just didn't know which policy it may have fallen under.
Mm-hmm. And I did not know that the demeanor was also covered in policy.
And were you aware that professional image is punishable by everything from written counseling to termination, depending on how many offenses and other disciplines?
Yes.
In 2011, you admitted in your statement, which we pretended as an exhibit, that you did use the F word 3 times in Chrissy Barber's presence, and that there was some tension in that encounter?
Yes.
In 2012, you described, and in the exhibit that we tendered, the issue that you had with the school secretary, Gina Estes, and in that you admitted that you used the F word twice while you talked to her, is that correct?
Correct.
And due to the fact that the prior year you'd had a discipline recommendation for professional image that included language and the use of that language, were you aware still that was a violation of policy?
For that instance, not completely, because one, I was off duty. I never identified myself as a deputy. As I stated before, I was in a heightened emotional state due to my 8-year-old son not being allowed off the school bus. And I believe it's in my statement that the way I did use the F word, I even somewhat apologized for using it. I do believe I said, "You'll have to pardon my French, but I want to know what the F is going on. Why is my son not allowed to get off the bus? Crying his F and I's out."
Now, prior to this, in 2011, after the professional image violation, Sergeant Donnie Dave testified that he had counseled you about your use of language in the F word, especially in front of civilians and administrative personnel. Is that correct?
Yes.
In July of 2012, you had already been written up for professional image in 2011, and then for use of foul language in 2012. So you were aware that your language could violate the policy depending on the circumstance?
Yes.
And you admitted that your attitude with the accident scene victim was probably not appropriate, you were having a bad day?
I was having a bad day, but I was not rude to him, in my opinion. I may have been very dry and flat and to the point and not entertaining his aggravation or heightened emotion, which probably upset him more.
And your conduct, according to the disciplinary action report, didn't do anything to help his conduct, but actually caused him to file a complaint and you to receive an 8-hour suspension for professional image. Is that correct?
Correct.
And in March of this year, you explained to the board that you forgot about the marijuana evidence in your trunk. Is that correct?
Yes.
And you knew that evidence is supposed to be submitted by the end of the shift?
I am aware that it's supposed to be submitted in a timely manner. It was never directly quoted to me at any point, nor did I know of the policy that it had to be done by the end of the shift.
But you submitted evidence in the 5 years that you worked here multiple times, is that correct?
Correct.
And the majority of the time, or all of the time other than this one, did it by the end of shift?
Majority of the time. There have been other times where it was the next day.
And since you'd already been disciplined for conduct unbecoming in 2012, you were familiar with the policy in 2013, I would guess.
Yes.
Did you know of the policy for neglect of duty?
I was aware of it.
Of the basics of what it said?
Yes.
And the policy on duty to read, understand, and comply with orders?
I was not aware of that one. I'd never read that one prior.
And in the 5 years that you worked here, you worked a lot of part-time jobs, is that accurate?
Fair amount, yes.
And so were you aware of the policy to call out on the radio for safety purposes?
I know it was required for most of us.
And you admitted and appeared in testimony that you did not do that at the Avenue part-time job.
Correct.
And you told us in our interview in Internal Affairs that while you were at the Avenue for 30 to 45 minutes that you were working on sheriff's office reports. Is that correct?
Correct.
And that was not the duties that you were supposed to be paid for from the Avenue?
Correct.
You also told us here that you turned in a timesheet that had on it that you were to be paid for 4 hours. Is that correct?
It had the amount of $140 on it.
The total of $140.
Yes.
Which equated to 4 hours of work.
Correct.
At the end. Mm-hmm. You also told us that you didn't work the 4 hours. Is that correct?
Correct.
You also said in the Internal Affairs investigation and here in this hearing that because it was a mistake and you didn't realize it, that you would have accepted the money if you had been paid $140.
Correct.
Were you also aware that accumulation of these policies could result in termination?
No.
So you weren't aware the five times that you were written up before and were provided a copy of the schedule of penalties for these, that on that schedule of penalties, all of these or the majority of these could result in termination? You were not aware of that?
No, I was, according to the schedule of penalties, going by the schedule of penalties and the prior infractions, the way I looked at it was I was looking at a 48-hour suspension.
So you were aware of the schedule of penalties from your previous discipline?
Yes.
You just didn't interpret it that it could result in termination?
No.
So the first part of the policy that says policy may exist that could possibly warrant a less severe or more severe type of corrective action, you just didn't read that the five times you were disciplined prior to this one?
I am aware that they have used.
I don't have any further questions.
Questions about members of the board?
Mr. Skowronski, first of all, I want to commend you for your military service, also serves as a peace officer. I can't imagine the things that you're exposed to every day as a peace officer. Having never served in the military, obviously never been a cop, I can't imagine. So we appreciate the service yourself as well as others. In reference to the timesheet issue, you had drawn out a sketch of the timesheet that obviously we don't have the actual timesheet, so we don't know exactly what it looks like.
Correct.
Typically on the timesheet, there's a place for hours, as you have stated, activities, duties, you've stated. Is there a place for a signature on the timesheet?
Yes.
And when you sign the signature on that, when you sign your signature on a timesheet, what does it usually mean?
Usually it means that you filled it out correctly and it's true state.
Did you sign that timesheet?
Yes. I pre-filled out my timesheet during that day. I filled out everything except for the hours. The hours on along the side of what I would be doing. And everything else was filled out. Phone number, my name, my signature, the pay, everything else was filled out except for the hours.
So you also pre-signed your timesheet before you actually worked the hours?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
It is a practice that I would do just to have it done. Hindsight being 2020. Don't do that.
Yeah, I can imagine being a police officer, you would sign many reports, and I know that would be tedious, but typically, as you said, by signing a timesheet or any other report for that matter, you are signing that you attest to the information that's there that it is accurate and correct. Is that a fair statement?
Yes.
On to the evidence in the trunk issue. Again, not having ever served as a deputy or a policeman, I'm not familiar with the procedure. After an arrest, after you take the evidence, whether it goes in your back seat, front seat, or trunk, and you finish your shift, or what, is there a report that you have to fill out on that particular incident?
As far as?
Well, the arrest.
There's an evidence sheet.
Evidence sheet, is there a report?
There's a report you do, and the report is done on the computer. Most times, the report is completed before you even get to, back to the precinct to turn in the evidence. And in there, you will state that, you know, this evidence was done. So there's a report that you do, and then there is also an evidence sheet that has to be completed that gets attached to the evidence to drop the evidence into the evidence locker. As I stated previously, I have done, that day I did 5 reports, and I was working from the time that I dropped the gentleman off at RYDC and went back, I was working inside. So my report was already done and approved by Sergeant Weeks. I did the other reports during that time. Like I stated, I forgot about the marijuana because it was in my trunk, and I did not go back to my car the rest of the evening until to go home. Like I've stated before, I fully admit that. I've never tried to hide anything. On the other end, I was never followed up on by the supervisor. He never came back and said, hey, did you remember to do everything? Did you get this done? That was never brought to me. That was never an option, which in previous times, they do come and check, and that's their job, is to check our reports and make sure we're doing everything we're supposed to do.
So once this report is entered, as you said, that some reports are entered by computer, who would that report go to? Your supervisor?
Yes.
Is there not something within a 24 or 48 hour period that would prompt that supervisor or wherever the evidence was supposed to go? Is there not something that would prompt them to say, hey, we have not received the evidence for this arrest? Is that not in place?
To a point, yes. As I stated before, it was a Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, I was off. I don't know when the evidence techs come down to pick up evidence, because we drop the evidence at the precinct. We have a bunch of lockers for evidence. How often or what days they come down to retrieve that, I'm not sure. I don't know their schedule. Saturday and Sunday, they don't. That's a given. They don't come down Saturday or Sunday. I believe from the previous documents that were introduced that it was discovered on the 29th, I believe, which was 2 days, be a Tuesday, I believe, after the weekend. So it was a relatively short amount of time that it was discovered to be missing. However, by the time Captain Hoffman had told Sergeant Weeks and told me, another day or two had passed, or another day had passed.
Well, you said after it was discovered missing that it was, you had turned it in, did whatever you needed to do within 48 hours of that, right?
When Sergeant Weeks came to me and told me it was not submitted to evidence, and I told him I would check my trunk, within 45 minutes it was submitted. I called him within 45 minutes to an hour and told him it's in evidence and dropped. That's when he went back with, he called an evidence back, brought the evidence back to him, because Sergeant Weeks was present when I confiscated the marijuana. He knew how much was there. He knew how it was packaged. So he could tell whether or not anything was missing. And he testified yesterday there was no discrepancy. Everything was there. It was not messed with.
But the long and short of it is we're talking about, again, what I've heard and what I see on the report, 9 days that the marijuana was in your trunk?
Yes.
Is that correct? Can you help but ask a question? I recognize there's a procedure, I recognize there's a protocol and policy, but how could you not remember you had marijuana in your trunk for 9 days?
As I stated before, I put it in a glass container, which seals it, so that there's no odor. I don't smell it. If I don't go into my trunk for whatever reason, I'm not going to see it there. I had no cause during that time to go into my trunk. Those 9 days, I only worked, I believe, was 3 days of those, I was off. Actually, 5 days of those, I was off. There was only 2 days of actual working that I would have had the opportunity to go into my trunk to realize my mistake.
Where was the patrol car for the 5 days you were off?
Parked in my driveway. I had a take-home car at the time.
To a different lieutenant. I have records of the
tyranny is now over.
I wish I could be back. I missed it.
But you were interested.
Yes, very much.
But they may not all be leaving like they used to, running from the
That's good.
Oppression. I know. They were running like crazy from that oppression.
Yeah, they were.
But luckily, Major Hester recognized that fairly quickly and reorganized. And so now all of those units that used to be under Matt, Lieutenant, or Sergeant are now under different supervisors. Escape from Sobibor in the movie. They all come around and just, you know. About two or three of them I know have come off med blood pressure medication. One of them doesn't have to take your heart meds anymore.
Oh, see? There we go.
He said he came.
Yeah, all. We didn't hear the kids. Things are getting corrected.
That's good. You're out of school left now. Same with school.
We'll resume the hearing. Let me inquire just briefly, Mr. Skowronski. You have one witness here. Do you have any other witnesses?
No, sir. This is my phone.
Do you intend to rest after?
Yes.
This witness. Does the county anticipate any rebuttal evidence at all?
I'll call myself for a very short rebuttal witness.
Okay.
It will be very short.
Okay. What we'll do is we'll do this witness, then you'll rest your case. We'll proceed with any rebuttal evidence, and then we'll move into closing argument. In closing argument, before we rest the case, we'll give you all about 10 minutes each to kind of prepare some notes, but we'd like to go ahead and move into that so we can try to get going as soon as we can. So after the case is closed, we'll have about 10 minutes. Normally, in normal cases, the party with the burden of proof, which is the county, has a right to open and conclude. In other words, begin the closing argument, and then Mr. Skowronski would make his closing argument, and then you can come back with concluding remarks. It's my understanding the board's policy is to encourage, but not require, whoever has that right to waive the opening. You don't have to, but just be thinking about that and what you want to do.
Yes, sir.
All right. Go ahead. Proceed.
You better swear to it.
I am. All right. Raise your right hand. Do you swear the testimony you're about to give in the matter now obtaining with you the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth of God? And say your name for the
record. Amanda McKenzie.
Amanda McKenzie.
Yes, sir.
Spell your last name.
M-C-K-I-N-Z-I-E.
And what is your employment?
Forsyth County Transportation. School bus driver.
Okay. All right. You may proceed.
Hey, young man.
Where are you?
How long would you say we've known each other?
About 3 years or more.
Have you previously worked for county?
Yes. For 10.5 years at the Sheriff's Department.
And what did you do for
them? 7.5 years I was a 911 operator, and the last were a GCIC operator.
What operator?
GCIC.
Is that where we first met?
Yes.
Did we have a lot of interaction during that time?
No. You come in and do work and leave.
There was a incident with your son that you had called 911 one evening, I believe, after you had left the Sheriff's Department. Could you describe what happened that night?
I have 5 children under 12. At that time, I think we were none. Anyway, my youngest son, he was 3, and I went to sleep with him. We all had like a fever virus. I guess I got it from the Sheriff's Office. And I put him to sleep, and I heard a noise like that. And it woke me up, and he was purple, not breathing. I jerked him up out of the bed, and I don't care how much training he got in 911, when it's 1 year old, that's all out the window. I gave him to my husband, and he still wasn't breathing. My husband was trying to do this finger sweep thing, and it choked. And I took off out of the house because I thought that if my son was dead, I didn't want to ever see him again. I know that might sound cruel, but that was my baby. So I went outside, called 911. I kept hanging up on them. Of course, that's not what we're trained to do, but I didn't want to talk to them. And two deputies flew by, and I called 911 back, told them I jumped in front of the fire truck, but it stopped because that would delay them. Anyway, they got in there. They took him into the kitchen area, and Ski and Officer Bill arrived at the house, and everybody kept trying to get me to go inside with him, and I wouldn't go inside. And before then, I really thought he was a jerk. I mean, that's my impression of him. I mean, in that type of job, I know you can't always have a soft shell. And a lot of officers, because I work with a lot, seem like they're just mean. And that was my opinion of him. But that night, everything changed. He stood right beside me and tried to calm me down. He took that badge off and was my friend, not just a coworker. Because that, in that moment, was the worst moment of my life. And I'll never forget it. And he was with me the whole time. And like I said, he didn't have to be. He could have just, oh, well, I'm here. The fire truck, the ambulance, this other officer's got it, but he stood right there by me. And he didn't know me more than coming in and doing more. It's just like any other deputy that came in. And then that night, I realized that I gained a friend. We've been friends ever since. He, to me, is my family, our whole family's friend. Now, it's not it for them. Sad that it had to happen that way. Or to think that he's a human after that incident, but I really appreciated what he did that night, because if I would have lost my son, I'd go. He was there for us, for it all.
Did you write a letter to my supervisor at that time?
Yes. I wrote a letter to be put in this spot for accommodation, because I deserve, I don't think they get enough credit for what they do. My husband, he's a deputy still, and I mean, I know that they don't get enough credit, which I'm sure, I think everybody doesn't get enough credit for what they do, but he really deserved to have a pat on the back, so everybody else that responded that night.
Do you remember calling me or texting me a couple days after that and asking if I had received that?
I made sure that, and I even emailed his supervisors, or whoever was above him, to make sure that that was placed in his file. And then 911, I know I didn't even get recognition for something, but I did. Not that I think that I should get one, but I think that it should have been put in his file to let everybody know that what he had done for us.
During that conversation, do you recall what my reply was about receiving that?
Well, you know, my mind is not as sharp as it always is with me having five kids, but I think you were very appreciative, is from what I remember. You were checking on Nolan even after
yes.
That would have had to happen, just to follow up with me. And like I said, he didn't know me for no more than me just coming in here and handing y'all paperwork. And that other officer, he helped us, but he was not the one standing by my side when I thought my son was dead, because I still wouldn't even go in there. And when I got in there, he finally said, let's go in there. We got him breathing. And I said, no, I'm not going in there. He's not breathing. And he was like, come on, we'll go in there. And I was thinking, you're always a jerk. So what am I going to go in there for? But like I said, it really changed my opinion about him. And I guess a lot of people are that way. Just have to get to know somebody.
Do you recall during the conversation that I had not received that letter from my supervisor?
I remember that, and then I think I emailed them a second or a third time to make sure. And they did tell me, because at the time I was working for the county, that they did get it and put it in the file. But it took me a few tries to make sure that was put in the file.
Cross-examination.
I have no questions.
Questions about members of the board?
No questions.
No questions.
Your son did get all right.
Yes, sir. I have spoiled him ever since that night. And he is the biggest baby ever. And I know that, but I mean, I go in the middle of the night just to make sure he's breathing.
Was he just choked?
He had a feeble seizure. And they rushed him to the hospital. And he went in there 2 seconds. The guy looked at his little eyes and checked his heart and stuff and goes, he had a feeble seizure, you can go home. I said, are you kidding me? All of that, when you think that's the worst moment of your life, because the air I breathe, all the more.
Right. Thank you, Ms. McKenzie.
I can leave now?
Yes. You don't have to, you can stick around.
Oh, that's okay, I'm gonna get some kids.
All right, thank you. Any further witnesses?
No, sir.
Do you rest your case this time?
Yes, sir.
Any rebuttal evidence?
Yes, sir, I call myself.
Okay. Sergeant Ward?
Just to clarify, if there was any confusion, several weeks ago, I was asked to attend a meeting with Solicitor General Donna Gopal and her Chief Assistant Ines Grant about some records issues, and one of the things that came up in that meeting was how to serve John Skowronski with some subpoenas and some pending cases that were coming up. And the Chief Solicitor Assistant Ines Grant said that many of the cases she could not prosecute due to credibility issues after his termination. There were a few cases where he was a secondary participant and not a primary participant, and that in those cases that she was still going to serve some subpoenas for him so that he could testify to some parts of that case. We told her we didn't have anything to do with serving subpoenas for the solicitor's office, and that we had no opinion in that case. But I just wanted to clarify that I was present at that meeting since that evidence was brought up by Mr. Skowronski.
Any further?
No, sir.
Any questions?
Yes. So during this meeting, it was decided that if I was secondary, she would go ahead and serve those subpoenas. Is that pretty much the gist of it? Some of them?
That was the gist of some of them.
I don't know if we can answer the question, but if my integrity and reputation has been destroyed, why would they even bother serving me a subpoena that I may have to testify even as a secondary witness?
I don't know.
I have no further questions.
Any questions by members of the board?
No questions.
You started off by saying John Skowronski. I'm sure you meant Walter.
Yes, sir. His name is John Walter Skowronski.
Oh, okay.
Sometimes I mix up.
Hadn't heard the John part. Okay. See it.
I go by John mostly.
Oh, you do?
My full name is Walter John Skowronski. But I go by John.
Okay.
No more questions.
Okay, thank you, Sergeant Boyer. Any served by the way? All right, so the case, all evidence will. Let me ask you, does anybody have anything else to present? I have exhibits FC 1 through 9 and Mr. Skowronski WS 1. See if I have anything else to present.
No.
Director of the county, Mr. Skowronski.
No, sir.
All right, the evidence will now be closed. Why don't y'all take about 10 minutes to prepare your closing arguments, and we'll come back at 20 minutes till 12 and allow you to begin those. How does the board like to receive the closing arguments? Do they want to stand?
No, they can sit it there. Say, if you don't mind, Mr. Chairman, I may say this. Really, we don't want to retry the case.
Yes.
And we encourage you to be as short as possible.
Yes, sir.
Or as brief as possible. And don't want to try your case, don't want to have anything to do with it. But we've heard the evidence, and I believe the closing is just a summation.
Yes.
So, you know, we'll go from there. Hearing officer, you're new and you're not aware of our past policies. Okay. I should let Ms. Clerk know. She does the best job.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. All right. So we'll be in recess until 20 minutes till. in closing argument, Sergeant Boyer may proceed first. How do you wish to proceed?
And you said we have the option to go last?
Yes.
Well, I'd like to go last.
Mr. Skowronski, may begin with closing argument.
I'm not going to try to rehash everything that's been said. I would like to touch on a few things. I'm not condoning my errors. I've owned up to every single one of them. There was never any intent to defraud anybody or try to receive payment for something I didn't do. Most mistakes I do are I come by them honestly, just sometimes my brain works, sometimes it doesn't. Like most normal human beings, I own up to them. I've been an officer for over 13 years, made plenty of mistakes. I've also done more good than mistakes I've done. I've saved lives. I've helped console people. I've been in situations that I have seen other officers fall apart in that I did not. I've been deputy of the month here at the SO. I've been recommended for deputy of the month at least six times. I've also been recommended for other accommodations. There are others in the SO that have done worse than me and have received less punishment. As I said before, there was no intent. I admitted it. I accepted what the department gave me. I think it was, in my personal opinion, excessive. I believe if some other people had done the same thing, there would have been less repercussions. They gave me no opportunity to explain myself as far as would I give the money back. Of course, I admit to, I would accept it because it was a mistake. That's me being honest. I'm not going to lie about it. I wouldn't say, oh no, I won't take it. Because I don't know anybody that, if they didn't know the mistake had happened, they wouldn't accept it. The avenues, they were satisfied. As far as I understood it with Mr. Turnbull, everything was settled and there was no ill will and we were to move forward. As far as being terminated, stated he never once spoke to me about anything, not even when he recommended termination. In his own memo, he said that he found my credibility with my supervisors had been irreparably damaged. I think I've shown yesterday that most of my supervisors and my peers do not feel that way. Captain Hoffman also stated that Sergeant Weeks wanted me gone. Sergeant Weeks said no, he never said that. He wanted suspension. That was overridden or ignored, as it apparently is his right to do. credibility has been irreparably damaged when my immediate supervisor at the time does not believe me to be dishonest. Contradicts us. Captain Hoffman contradicts Sergeant Weeks. It does not make sense. Whatever your decision is, I have no choice but to abide by it. I will accept it. What I would like to see is, ultimately, I would like reinstatement. If you find that you are unable to reinstate me for whatever reason, I would ask that the charges of the violation of law, the attempt to commit a theft and a false statement, be unsubstantiated, as I think I've proven that there was no intent, it was a mistake, a bad mistake, that I admitted to. Also, not at any point prior to termination, which has happened in the past, was I afforded the opportunity to resign. So again, if you are unable to reinstate me, I would like, as I said before, the violation of law charges unsubstantiated, and I would like to have my status terminated to resign. I've already been turned down by a department because they looked at my post and saw terminated. Effectively, being terminated in the state of Georgia pretty much kills your career. And I will not be able to work law enforcement pretty much in the state of Georgia or anywhere else. They don't look highly on somebody who's been terminated for whatever reason. I enjoy my job. I am human. I have issues like everybody else. Most of my issues have been resolved. As you can tell, most of my issues were in a two-year period. I like doing what I do. I like helping people. I like responding to places to help people. I am from New York City. I come across rough. I have been told some people think I'm rude when they first meet me because I'm quiet. I don't say anything. That may be part of New York. That may be part of 13 years of law enforcement. I tend not to speak. I'll stand back, see what's going on, and let other people decide how my demeanor is going to be. With that being said, like I said, I enjoy doing police work. I have since 2000. I would like to continue it, whether it be with this department or another. And the only way to do that, like I said, one of these ways that I've asked for.
Okay, thank you. Sergeant Boyer.
The board has heard all the same testimony that I've heard. We heard lots of admissions of mistakes, lots of excuses for why this happened and why somebody didn't check on me and why somebody didn't take care of me and why somebody didn't prompt me to do things. We also heard testimony from his own witnesses that he's hard to get along with, that he's a jerk and various things that all contribute to the overall attitude and pattern of misconduct that Mr. Skowronski was a part of. In a relatively short time, in 2 years, he had 6 disciplinary recommendations, some of those very serious. Evidence left in a trunk destroys the chain of custody. That case won't be prosecuted. there's too many loopholes in there for that to happen. That's a serious violation. Professional image, conduct unbecoming, all these things that we discussed. These are not minor violations where I've made a mistake and I need to correct it. He's right, we all make mistakes. I've been a cop for over 19 years and I've never made these mistakes. I've never made any mistakes like this or this severe. We have 366 employees in the sheriff's office. I can tell you that the majority of them have not made these kinds of mistakes in their careers this many times. The recommendation for termination was done by Captain Hoffman. It was concurred with all the way to the sheriff, and they agreed with that because it was the right thing to do based on the seriousness of the allegations and the sustained misconduct that Mr. Skowronski participated in. Not only the pattern from the five previous, but the sixth one, there was some discussion of the violation of law. You have in the exhibit number five, there's an or and some semicolons in there that Mr. Skowronski did not discuss that I would encourage you to look at. Or makes or uses any false writing or document, knowing the same to contain any false, fictitious, or fraudulent statement. There's no requirement for intent, although by giving that to somebody, I believe that is intent, but there's no requirement for that. The attempt to commit theft, he admitted, it's in the evidence, that he turned in the timesheet for $140, that he did not work. He admits that he would have received the money. He admitted to that. And then if he had remembered that he actually didn't work it, then he would have given the money back. Well, I work part-time jobs. And I know what I worked and when I worked and what money I'm supposed to get. I know exactly how much money's coming and exactly when it's coming. And I would know I didn't work this job and I don't deserve this $140, and I wouldn't think, well, I guess I must have worked something I don't remember and just keep it. But that's basically what Mr. Skowronski testified to. He was given the opportunity to say anything else about the incident during his investigation, and he didn't say anything about I would have given the money back if somebody had told me or I didn't remember it and some of those various things. He only admitted and tried to fix things when he was caught. And in very many of these instances, once he was caught is when, but there was no self-correction. There was no, I need to fix this stuff before it happens. When he got caught, he would attempt to fix things. That is not the character of a Forsyth County deputy that the sheriff wants in the sheriff's office. The credibility of Mr. Skowronski is in question. It is not existent in the Forsyth County system for him to be able to continue to perform his job. The sheriff knew that, which is why he concurred with the recommendation to terminate. We would ask that you uphold the termination of Mr. Skowronski for the citizens of Forsyth County. That's who we serve in the sheriff's office. Mr. Skowronski is not the type of representation of the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office that the sheriff wants the citizens to deal with. We've heard lots of testimony. He is not the type of representative that the sheriff wants in the sheriff's office. And due to the serious nature of many of these violations and this pattern of violations, we would ask that you uphold this termination of Mr. Skowronski.
Thank you, Sergeant. With that, the hearing, Mr. Skowronski will be closed. I'll turn it back over to the chairman at this time.
Okay, thank you. You got all the evidence?
I do.
Everything's
ship
shape.
Yeah.
Gentlemen, due to the nature of the hour and to the pending appointments that some of our members have this afternoon, is in agreement with y'all, we'll adjourn this meeting and get back together Monday morning at 10 o'clock, I suppose, in the boardroom?
Yes, we'll find a location here.
Ms. Clerk will find the location. And at that time, we'll go into executive session to render a decision or start working on the decision. Is that in agreement with y'all?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Hearing Officer, 10 a.m. on Monday morning?
Yes, sir.
Here. We'll meet then. But there, all the things where the meeting is, we finished our meeting from yesterday, so at this time, I'd ask for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to adjourn. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. The meeting is adjourned.
Thank you for
all
right.
Sitting there on the procedure.
Y'all both.
Yeah.